at the actual committee statement, which I'll get up and read, which goes to the intent of this law, expressly takes away the authority of the cities to be able to regulate the possession of firearms. And that means all rules, measures, and ordinances.
Time, Senator.
Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Moorfield. Senator Blood.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. Fellow senators, those that are in the chambers and paying attention, friends all, we've got another wedge issue. And what I notice as a freshman senator when we have a wedge issue is that unfortunately people are not listening to the debate and have their minds made up. And I think that's a mistake, because on wedge issues, what I'm seeing is you're either with us or you're against us, and there is no middle ground. But guess what? The vast majority of people that own guns in Nebraska are moderate when it comes to the rules that pertain to their gun ownership, me being one of them. Now, we hear this great speech about how this is about Second Amendment and their rights to bear arms. Well, I sit on this committee just like the senator does that said that, and we were told during the hearing that no, this bill is about being able to safely transport our weapons across the state of Nebraska from one community to another without fear of prosecution. And to me, that seems logical. And from the very beginning, I've said I support that impression. I support that. Because if you are a lawful gun owner transporting a gun for a lawful purpose, you should be protected. But with that said, I don't think LB 68 is a good bill. We're talking about the bill, not whether you think everybody should have a gun and do whatever the heck they want to do with it, within reason, or because you are a responsible gun owner, that all it's about is gun ownership. That's not what this bill is about. We were told this bill is about preventing a patchwork. But guess what? Omaha's carved out. And what's being left out of this conversation is that, yeah, we gave Omaha a carve out and we've compromised, but guess what? Omaha's still coming in neutral. They are not in support of this bill. And when we talked about it last time, one of the issues that we asked about is why weren't other communities contacted? And it was kind of put on OPOA as the reason that these other communities weren't contacted. Well, when I write a bill, LB 88 being a really good example, I had 20 letters of support from almost every entity that was included in my bill, because that's my job as a senator, I personally believe. So I'm concerned about those things, but I'm really concerned about the robo emails that I got, the same issue over and over and over again. And one of them I got was, don't give in to partisan politics and special interest. Well, the only special interest people I had knocking on my door were paid lobbyists for the various gun entities. I didn't have any special interest groups coming to my door, because I expressed to them that I am a responsible gun ownership, and I support responsible gun ownership. And of all the hundreds of emails that I personally answered, if they were from my district, only three people took issue with my explanation of why I did not support 68. One of them was because she wanted the right to sue municipalities if she didn't agree with any laws that they should pass. One of them was offended because I suggested the NRA does any lobbying in reference to guns. And the third person was just that, you know, I just really want to have something passed, and so it's nothing against you personally, but I think 68's our only chance. So I go back to what was said in the hearing. With that, I would ask if Senator Hilgers could yield to a quick question.
Senator Hilgers, could you yield, please?
Absolutely.
Senator, what percentage would you say of those that testified that as law-abiding gun owners, that they wanted the opportunity to transport their guns for legal purposes across the state? Of all those that testified, what percentage would you say said that?
Percentage of people
in our hearing that came and spoke?
Who said what?
That they wanted to be able to transport their guns legally across Nebraska.
I think all the supporters said that.
With that said, I would ask that those that have amendments that they have turned in, that they remove, that they consider removing their amendments so Amendment 865 can come to the floor for debate, because if you read my amendment, it clearly states and gives people the opportunity to transport weapons across the state of Nebraska without fear of prosecution and without all this mess that still needs to be fixed in 68. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Blood.
Senator Epke.
Thank you, Mr. President. You know, I find an interesting dichotomy in what we've talked about today. LB 158. We talked a lot about constitutional rights, and we said, gosh, the Constitution is the Constitution, whether you're in Lincoln County or Douglas County or Furnace County or Lancaster County. Everybody is entitled to a right to counsel. And then today, we hear the other side of the story. The right to keep and bear arms needs to be limited to the local based on the local circumstances in Omaha or in Lincoln or whatever. So I find this kind of interesting. I would point my colleagues not just to the Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, but to Article 1, Section 1 of the Nebraska Constitution, and then the correlating amendments to the U.S. Constitution, the Sixth Amendment right to counsel in the U.S. Constitution, and Article 1, Section 11 of the Nebraska Constitution. We need to decide whether the Constitution is the Constitution or whether we can pick and choose based on where we live what elements of the Constitution we're going to protect. And with that, I would yield the remainder of my time to Senator Hilgers.
Thank you, Senator Epke.
Senator Hilgers, 3.5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Epke. I completely echo your comments regarding the importance of our constitutional rights. I want to respond to a few of these points, and I love nothing more than debate with other attorneys. And I say that seriously because counsel have been trained in how to read statutes and their arguments, and I enjoy the back and forth. And it reminds me, when Senator Moorfield was speaking, it reminds me of something my first year law professor told me, was that the first one who calls another argument absurd has lost. And I counted, I think, at least three absurds from Senator Moorfield. And he waved his book around and he said, "This is not what Senator Hilgers says. Look at my book, it's really big." It does not do what Senator Moorfield is saying. What 68 does, it eliminates the power of cities to enter into ordinances or other rules where that power comes from them to regulate possession. It doesn't say anything about their ability to apply state law at all. That power comes from the state. It's there. Now, the statutory interpretation guide that Senator Moorfield references is when the two provisions are in conflict. And in my view, those two statutory provisions are not in conflict at all. So, what Senator Moorfield says LB 68 does, I do not believe, is correct. Nevertheless, as I said in the beginning, we want to make good legislation. And I take seriously those concerns, and I take seriously those who said, hey, we would like certainty. And so we have worked and are working on a potential amendment that would make clear what I think is already in LB 68 and would work on that between general and select. Again, I think LB 68 is clear and it applies, but to make certain on some of these concerns, given how seriously we do take public safety, I'm willing to consider an amendment on select file that would address that and make clear. Belt and suspenders, as they say. Now, the other argument from my other attorney friend, Senator Hansen, is that this is special legislation. And this is sort of the Hansen argument, and I say that with all seriousness and all due respect because he raised that in LB 289. But as Senator Hansen knows, there is a test from the Nebraska Supreme Court on what is special legislation, and it's a two-pronged test. And the test is it a closed class, meaning can other entities become a member of that class? And two, is it arbitrary? In other words, did you just draw it out of whole cloth? Did you just want to give it to somebody because of who they were and not because of any rational reason? Both of those tests fail here. Because no matter what class you're talking about, whether it's the city of Omaha carve out itself or the right of individual or organizations to sue, neither of those are closed. Neither of them are. Someday, maybe soon, maybe in a couple years, City of Lincoln will be a city of the metropolitan class. It is not closed, colleagues. And it is certainly, above all else, it is not arbitrary. As opposed to waving around books and making claims of this great threat to public safety, what the Omaha police did over the course of many hours in the hearing, outside of the hearing, in meetings with us and others, they went over and over and over again, laid out their case on the evidence and why Omaha is different. Omaha has a specific gang problem. They know exactly how they're using their tools. They know the impact, And they proved it. And it's our obligation as legislators to listen. That's what we did. And that's why Omaha's different. Now, I can say...
Time, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Hilders.
Senator Bosselman.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, colleagues in Nebraska. I'm going to take a little bit different stand, a little different approach to what we're talking about today to bring some personal effects, I guess, a personal experiences with shooting sports and firearms in our state. I rise in opposition to the Motion 70, and I do support LB 68. We currently have a patchwork of gun laws in the state, and we need to address preemption. Preemption can fix that. And what do I mean? I've been involved with shooting sports for a number of years now. Shooting sports is growing exponentially across the state and across this country. Shooting sports includes pistols, air rifles, shotguns, rifles, and black powder. These involve activities at junior high school youth, and even younger youth when it comes to air rifles and Daisy rifles. They're competing across the state. They're competing in our cities and towns. They are traveling from place to place either to compete or to practice. In fact, the largest high school competitive trap shoot in the nation will occur in about a month right here in the state of Nebraska. We're going to have youth traveling from across the nation to come to Nebraska to shoot in this competition. The National 4-H Shooting Sports Competition is also held in the state within the next month. I was involved with youth in 4-H shooting, in 4-H shooting, especially in trap shooting. We also shoot sporting clays. We also shoot skeet. There's also pistol shooting involved with that as well with our youth. Understand that when these youth come in to shoot, first thing they do is they go through hunter education courses. They're taught how to properly handle, identify, and safely maintain that firearm. How to use that firearm in a safe manner. After they go through that instruction, then they come out to the 4-H instructors, and then we teach them, once again, in whatever discipline it is that they're looking to do, we teach them how to properly handle, transport, and fire that weapon, that firearm. In trap, let me tell you something. I've stood beside a kid that's in a youth shooter as a freshman, and he had a very difficult time in focusing on anything he did. Anything. I literally would have to stand up on the line, what we call on the line in a shooting position, to remind him, stand a certain way, be ready to shoot, shoulder your rifle, call for your target, shoot your target, and stand there, and keep him focused on what we're doing. Over the time that we had working with him, by the time he started as a freshman to the time he finished as a senior, he was one of the top shooters that we had in our club. It taught him how to focus, how to pay attention. It taught him important skills, life skills, that he will use now and into the future in his job and in his personal life. The youth benefit directly in this sport. That is something we all need to remember, and it does affect each and every one of us. As someone who actively teaches and trains, as I said, here in Nebraska, how to be a responsible gun owner, it is particularly important to protect our Second Amendment rights. It is also important that I can teach Nebraskans how to follow the law. Those who shoot recreationally and competitively regularly travel with their firearms through our cities. The current patchwork makes it very hard for them to know how they should transport and where they are allowed to possess. Responsible, lawful gun owners do not want to break the rules. That is why we need laws that any layperson can understand. We don't have that now, but we will with the passage of LB 68. This bill represents progress that we should all feel proud to get behind. Let's support the committee amendment and vote green on LB 68, and I give the remainder of my time to Senator Hilders. Thank you.
Thanks, Senator Bosselman. Senator Hilders, a half minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Bostelman. In these brief seconds, I will rebut one of the points that Senator Crawford made, which is that this does not actually solve the patchwork problem. It does not do everything the green copy of LB 68 did. That is absolutely true. However, it does provide safe transport through Omaha. It provides a mechanism that does not exist now to Nebraska citizens to enter into the city limits of Omaha with their firearm and not break the law. So that is not true. Omaha is different, but there is safe transport through Omaha under AM 630. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Hilders. Senator Halloran announced his following guests visiting the legislature today. We have with us 20 fourth graders and 7 teachers from the Adams Central Wallace School in Hastings, Nebraska. All those students and teachers are with us in the East Balcony. If they could all please rise, I'd like to welcome you to the Nebraska legislature. Items for the record, Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Mr. President. Your Committee on Enrollment and Review reports Legislative Bill 75, 376, and 417 as correctly engrossed and placed on final reading. Enrollment and Review reports Legislative Bill 44, 44A, and 225A, all to select file. Your Committee on Judiciary reports Legislative Bill 145, 259, 395, 411, 526, along with all to general file, some with amendments, and Judiciary reports LR 26 and LR 27 to the full legislature for further consideration. That's all I have at this time.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Continuing debate, Senator Howard.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield my time to Senator Moorfield.
Thank you, Senator Howard. Senator Moorfield, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Senator Howard. I want to go through a few different things. First, Senator Hilders stated that I said absurd 3 times, and so that I've already lost the absurdity argument and lost the legal argument. Well, there's another famous law professor that said something 3 times as well. Read the statute, read the statute, read the statute. So we're going to read through the statute. First, LB 68 explicitly, and as Senator Hilders stated earlier himself, explicitly states that a local municipality or local county government may not create a rule, measure, or ordinance. Now, let's read the more general trespassing statute. Out of 28.521, a person commits second-degree criminal trespass if A, knowing that he or she is not licensed or privileged to do so, enters or remains in any place with notice against trespass that is given by 1, actual communication to the actor, 2, posting in a manner prescribed by law or reasonably likely to come to the attention of intruders, or 3, fencing or enclosure manifestly designed to exclude intruders. Now, in order to give notice, and in order to communicate that, the city or the county must have a rule, measure, or ordinance and place a sign and give notice. If they can't give notice, then that person is privileged to be there because it's public property. And what this bill is doing, LB 68, even as amended, what it's doing is stating that a city or a county cannot do that. They cannot issue a rule, measure, or ordinance. So they may not give notice to a public individual that they are not allowed to be in possession of a firearm in that public facility. It's not absurd. It's a pretty plain reading of the statute. It's a fairly simple interpretation of the statute, particularly if LB 68 is passed. That is why the Lincoln Police Department's opposed to this. That's why the county sheriffs are opposed to LB 68 on the green copy. This is a very simple reading of the statute as proposed. It's not absurd. And I'll continue to call it absurd because it is absurd to say that our current trespass statute would trump this more narrowly construed proposed statute. Also, Senator Ebke got up today and said that we're somehow violating the constitutional rights. We're not in support of gun rights. Right now, individuals have the ability to challenge the constitutionality of current ordinances. I'm sure it's happened in the past. They have the ability to do that now. We also have the ability to look at a certain ordinance and say, you know what, as a state, we don't believe that the city should be able to pass that kind of ordinance. We think that that ordinance is so absurd that we want to take away the ability of a city or a county to pass that ordinance. We can do that right now. Instead, what we're doing is just going, yeah, we're just going to take them all away. Because, you know, the reality in Ainsworth is the same reality in North Lincoln, where people get shot every year, or North Omaha, where people get shot pretty much every month.
One minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. Also, in regard to Omaha coming to the table, the reason why Lincoln didn't come to the table after talking to him was because they were opposed to it. As with a lot of other different agencies. And so, yes, OPA came to the table. They made a deal. I don't see them out in the lobby excitedly lobbying for it. And not only that, it does the exact opposite of what this bill proposes to do, which is create a patchwork where a third of our population lives in the city of Omaha. Also, I have not been given one example of a law-abiding citizen who's carrying their gun that somehow ended up in jail unexpectedly because they didn't know of a certain city ordinance and they were just traveling from one place to another for Thanksgiving or going to a sporting event. When you are a gun owner, you have a heightened expectation to understand the rules, the ordinances, and the laws when you travel with that firearm. I know that as a gun owner. Other people do. This is not a problem. This is a made-up problem, colleagues. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Moorfield. Senator Hilgers.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to respond to that last point and strongly disagree with my friend and colleague, Senator Moorfield, that this is a made-up problem. I read story after story after story on the floor last week about individuals who were forced to make a choice between lawfully exercising their constitutional rights and violating a law or not exercising those rights. Again, we heard from single mothers. We heard from members of our armed forces. Colleagues, this is a real problem. And the notion, I think, that the standard for burdens on constitutionality is, well, how many people have been arrested? You know, there hasn't been that many people arrested. There's been maybe a couple. So therefore, this is an appropriate burden. That should not be the standard. The standard is, or should not be that standard. In my view, what is currently going on in Nebraska is an impermissible burden. So this is a real problem. It may not be a problem for everyone. People can afford concealed carry permits. People who have a spouse who can watch the kids so they can get off work to go get their firearm registered. Someone who's lived their entire life in Lincoln and never has a problem with the prohibited person statutes. But it's a problem for a lot of people, and we ought to hear their voices. I want to talk a little bit about this notion of liability, because I think it's an important point. The idea that LB 68 broadens the scope of lawsuits that would in some way turn in this to some plaintiff's haven for people to file suits against cities, I think is totally incorrect. And let me give you a different example to kind of explain why I think it's incorrect. If we were to pass a state statute that said cities in Nebraska can no longer levy a sales tax, let's just say that's what it was, and we said you can't do it, and the city of Lincoln or some other municipality said, nah, we're not going to listen to you, we're going to go ahead and do it anyway, we absolutely would want a mechanism to challenge those. That's not right. If they did as the statute directed, if they didn't levy a sales tax, they would never be sued. There would never be a problem. The same thing is true with LB 68. The mechanism for relief is not triggered at all unless the cities do what they're told not to do. It's as simple as that. If they have an ordinance and they apply it as to gun ownership, they ought to be sued. And what it does is it makes it easier. You know, there are the people I'm talking about, the stories I've had, these are not people of means. They're not people who have the ability or the time to go hire attorneys. The one time Omaha's registration ordinance was challenged for being unconstitutional, for being applied to a permanent resident, which it could not do, that portion was carved out. And that individual was an immigrant not of means. It was supported by fire rights supporting organization. It's right to give those people a mechanism to protect themselves. If the cities just follow the statute, there will never be a lawsuit. It's as simple as that. I do enjoy my back and forth with Senator Moorfield because I do think it's educational. And I do think he's wrong when it comes to the trespass statute. For one, we know how to repeal statutes. We know how to modify statutes. 28-521 is not a city ordinance, okay? If it was a city ordinance in Omaha or Lincoln, absolutely this would be gutted. I completely agree. It's not. It's in the Nebraska state statutes. So if we wanted to pull that out and take away the city's ability to do it, we would know how to do that. We would amend that statute. We'd strike it. We'd do something to 28-521. Now, Senator Moorfield discussed in detail that 521 would nevertheless not be applicable because it would require a rule. Well, I got to tell you, I have looked through all the sections of 521, and there is nothing in here, colleagues, that I've seen, and I'll ask Senator Moorfield when he comes back, that says that this can only be applied via a rule. There's nothing in here, colleagues. Individuals have the power to restrict their rights to property. Again, on that point, I'm willing to belt and suspenders that if necessary. This, as I said at the beginning, is not intended to be an open, wild, wild west situation. There's also been a lot of time. How much time do I have left, Mr. President?
20 seconds.
Okay. My next time at the mic, I'm going to speak in a little bit more detail about the public safety aspects of LB 68. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Hilders. Senator Quick.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I just want to say, I know I spoke on this last time, and I just want to make sure everybody understands that I also am a gun owner and responsible gun owner. I have friends and family who are responsible gun owners, and I appreciate what they want to do with the bill as far as being able to have a uniform way of carrying guns across the state. The issue that I have with the bill, and that actually the city of Grand Island would have with the bill, is a part that would allow for a person to file a lawsuit. And as it states in the language, it says a person adversely affected by an ordinance, a measure, an enactment, a rule, or policy adopted and enforced by a city or village that violates this section may file an action in court of competent jurisdiction against a city or village for, and then it goes down to describe all those things that they can file for. Actually, on the way back to Grand Island the other day, I talked to a constituent on the phone. They wanted me to support LB 68, and I said, have you actually read the bill? Do you know what's in there? And I said, do you understand there's a part in there that the city or county could be sued? And they said, no, they only read just a little bit of the first page and maybe just what other people told them. And I said, well, maybe you should read the bill and then get back to me and let me know what you think. They have not called me back yet. I also stopped in to talk to the city attorney of Grand Island. I talked to the mayor of Grand Island and the city administrator and talked to them about what this bill maybe could do. And they have had great concerns as well. I was wondering if, and I apologize to Senator Hildred, I didn't tell him I was going to ask him a question. I was wondering if I can ask if you would yield you a question.
Senator Hildred, yield, please.
Absolutely.
Do you know, can a person under this bill, if let's just say the city has no ordinance, but if they did want one where they didn't want someone to bring a gun into a city council chambers, can someone just carry a gun in open carry into under this law? Can they carry a gun into a city council meeting?
If LB 68 passes,
yeah.
In my view, the answer would be no. But that's what I said. I'm happy to clarify that with a clarifying amendment to make that clear.
Okay. And what about, like, I worked at the power plant. We could not bring guns onto the power plant site. Now, that's a public, it's not City Hall, it's not, but it is owned by public utility. Mm-hmm. And but they don't allow guns on there, and it's not posted, but they would probably post it. Could they be sued?
No, in my view, no.
Yeah. Well, I don't, you know, it seems to me it conflicts with what the language says, but I don't know that there's any guarantees of that. So with that, I would like to see, the other concern I had is they carved out a section for Omaha. Now, and I know we brought up the fact that maybe Lincoln maybe could fall into that too. And I can tell you that Grand Island has gang violence as well. Their police officers are in danger at certain points, and I think that they would want to make sure that they can provide for public safety in ways just like Omaha does and Lincoln does. And so I would, you know, I'm still opposed to this. I would like to see Senator Blood's amendment, 865, if that would be possible at some point, to see if that's something that we could bring into this that maybe help the situation. Because I understand what people are trying to do, and they want to carry their guns across Nebraska without having recourse. But I want to make sure that we're not setting a precedent that's going to create a lot of consequences that we don't want to see. And I would yield and render my time to Senator Moorfield.
Thank you, Senator Quick. Senator Moorfield, 1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Quick. I want to respond to Senator Hilger's statement earlier that this does not prohibit individuals from stating that you're trespassing. He's right. Individuals have the right on their private property to state whether or not someone's trespassing and regulate possession of firearms on their own private property. But that's not what this bill is regulating. This bill is regulating a governmental entity. And we are prohibiting a rule, measure, or ordinance from going into effect with the possession of guns. And if you don't think that the court is going to interpret putting a sign on Pinnacle Bank Arena or the courthouse saying you can't have firearms in here, if you don't think that they're going to interpret that as a rule, a measure, or an ordinance, probably not an ordinance, definitely a rule or a measure, you've got to be kidding me. And I'll get the plain meaning of a rule, measure, or ordinance the next time I speak. The interpretation that somehow the trespass statute is going to trump this more narrowly construed statute
time, Senator.
Is false. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Moorfield. Mr. Clerk.
Mr. President, a priority motion, Senator Chambers, is moved to bracket the bill until June 2nd, 2017.
Senator Chambers, recognized to open on your bracket motion.
Thank you. Mr. President, members of the legislature, I understand that the NRA and their lobbyist, John Bruning and whoever he's got, they're going to try to say that amendments are going to be offered to clean up the bill. Well, you can vote cloture, but you're not going to have a chance to get to any amendments of any kind. I will see to that. And I'm going to show you some things that I think are so bad with this bill, I may be the one to bring a declaratory judgment action. When I said I would do that against an ordinance that the Omaha City Council passed to allow red light traffic cameras, they laughed at me. The city attorney laughed at me. He said he had looked at the Constitution, considered the law carefully, studied what happened in other states, and I could get nowhere. And I just pointed out that they're dealing with me, not another state or somebody else. I filed my action, and I won. The ordinance was declared unconstitutional. The city council rescinded it, which is what I sought in my declaratory judgment. But before I go into other things, I'd like to ask Senator Hilgers a question or two.
Senator Hilgers, you yield, please.
Absolutely.
Senator Hilgers, if I file a declaratory action and I'm allowed damages in that action, what actual damages can I claim if I file a suit under the language of this bill where I say I was adversely affected? Tell me the actual damage that could be recovered.
Senator Chambers, it depends on the context or the situation. If, for instance, you were, if the ordinance were enforced and you got something on your record and you lost your job, potentially
No, it was not enforced against me. It's just on the books. And the city has declared no intent to enforce it, but it's there. Tell me the actual damage that I would suffer.
It would probably be fairly nominal, whatever that damages were, your time.
And in addition to that, they allow consequential damages, and you know what those are, and I won't go into a lot of time because I don't want to run out of time on that. Can you envision any consequential damages if there are no actual damages?
No.
Neither can I. I'm just trying to get some things into the record so you know I'm not playing fast and loose with the bill. There are things in this bill that will not apply. If I file my declaratory judgment action, I will tell you that this bill actually by its terms makes machine guns legal. On page 19, and I'm going to eliminate the excess verbiage, and I hope Senator McDonald listens because I think he's a man of the law still, even though they may have pulled him to their side. On page 19, beginning in line 24, it shall be unlawful to transport or possess a machine gun unless it is unloaded and contained in any enclosed case or unloaded and broken down. Senator McDonald is in favor of a bill that says if I have a machine gun in Omaha and it's in a closed case, it's legal. That's by state law, but it can't trump the federal law. But the state law contains what would have to be an unconstitutional provision. Do you know what laws are supreme in this country? The Constitution, federal laws enacted pursuant to the Constitution, and all treaties into which this country has entered. Any state law or constitution to the contrary notwithstanding. You can pass an unconstitutional law. You can put an unconstitutional provision, which is what this is. When the lawsuit would be filed, you cannot prove any actual damages. And contrary to what may have been suggested, this bill says by its language, anybody can be one of these adversely affected persons if you own a gun and if you're in that city for any purpose, which means if you're passing through that city to get from one place to the other, you were adversely affected during the time you were in that city. So you could bring this guy from Texas and he can drive through Omaha because the NRA wrote these bills. They've engineered lawsuits in other states against municipalities and counties, whatever the term is they use to designate the political subdivision. He drives through Omaha. The ordinance is on the books, wasn't enforced, won't be enforced, but since he is by definition an adversely affected person, he can file a lawsuit against the city of Omaha by the terms of this bill. They're not going to change that. There are contradictions in this bill. This bill says that a city cannot regulate ammunition. The definition of ammunition includes propellant powder. The powder used in a bullet to propel it. Cities are prohibited by the language in this bill from regulating ammunition. Yet, the existing law, and it's not amended out, so it's a part of this bill, specifically allows the city to regulate and prohibit the transporting of gunpowder. So the statute that prohibits it is the statute that authorizes it. It does both things. So the court is going to say, which should we believe? Which should we enforce? The part that says the cities can prohibit and even arrest people for using fireworks, other combustibles, and explosives. The city can do that, but under the definition of ammunition, which the cities are prohibited from regulating, they cannot do those things without violating the very law that says they are specifically authorized to do it. Now, is the court going to try to untangle all that? I have another question I'd like to ask Senator Hilgers, the resident counsel for the discombobulated. Senator Hilgers, this bill doesn't have a severability clause, does it?
Correct.
Thank you. Members of the legislature, that clause alone will not save a bill which the clause will say, making it simple, anything that is found to be unconstitutional in this bill shall be stricken down without affecting whatever else remains in the bill. But the Nebraska Supreme Court has said that if that part which was stricken down as unconstitutional formed a basis for enacting the rest of it, then all of the law that was passed is struck down. That's Nebraska law. The NRA doesn't care about Nebraska law. NRA doesn't care about the citizens. I care about the law. I care about the citizens. I care about our process. Our process is being demeaned and abased by this piece of legislation, which I call trash legislation. The city of Omaha did not enter an unholy alliance with the NRA. That was the police union. That was the police. The police, not the city. The city is still against this bill. The letter that I got, the city council and the mayor are against this bill. That's the last information that I have from the city of Omaha. The police don't speak for Omaha. But I'd like to ask Senator Hilders another question if he'll answer.
I'm permanently yielding you to you.
Thank you,
Senator
just
Chambers.
For the record. Senator Hilders, if this were to become law, this bill, forgetting everything else I said, what would be the minimum age at which somebody in Omaha could own a firearm?
State law is 18 years old.
So, despite the police saying that, okay, that's all I need from you, thank you.
1 minute.
The police were arguing that when you let these people younger than 21 buy these guns legally, then the gang bangers are going to have these people buy the guns. They can buy 30 guns legally and then transmit and hand them out. And these 18-year-olders don't have records. So they will be legal purchasers of these firearms and they'll be misused in my community. And that's why the police would cut a deal like that. But they're finding out now that the shootings are bleeding over into the white community. This is a pernicious piece of legislation. That comment that I made is one of very few that I make about the negative impact on my community specifically. I think there are enough other major flaws in this bill to make it amenable to an attack in court. And even though I have other things to do with my time, thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Chambers. Continuing debate on LB 68 and the pending motion, Senator Vargas.
Thank you very much, President. I wondered if Senator Hilders would yield to a question.
Senator Hilders, yield, please.
Absolutely.
Great. Thank you very much. So my question is, we're hearing a lot about these beginning conversations, negotiations. Can you talk to me a little bit about who were involved in these negotiations? Who were the organizations, individuals?
Sure. We've had conversations with a lot of individuals and a lot of entities, but the primary one that led to the compromise, Senator Vargas, is that?
Yeah.
The primary entity with which we discussed these issues was the OPOA, Omaha Police Officers Association. They, in turn, had additional law enforcement groups in the greater Omaha metro area with whom they were discussing these issues. I don't know the full list, Senator McDonald would likely know, but the point group that we discussed these with, but not the only one, was OPOA.
Were there any special interest groups part of this as well?
What do you mean by special interest
groups? Any groups that are representing different organizations or other individuals? I mean, I'm looking at the list of individuals that are proponents and opponents.
Mm-hmm.
There are different, I would say, special interest groups on both sides, either proponents or opponents. I was wondering if any of these individuals that have a stake in this were at these meetings.
Are you talking about on the other side or on my side?
Oh, on either side.
On either side? Oh, we discussed this with the Nebraska Firearm Owners Association, okay, as well as the NRA.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. And I ask this question because I want to, you know, I think when we come here and we're having this conversation and this is considered, Senator Blood mentioned this as a wedge issue, that we actually have different stakeholder groups involved in the negotiations to ensure we have all broad perspectives. I very much appreciate that the Omaha Police Officers' voice was included in this. I think that's an important perspective. I also would want to make sure that it sounds like at some point there was the county attorneys maybe or public defenders. I don't know what role they might have played. And I mentioned special interest groups because sometimes we say that in a negative pejorative way. I mean a group that is essentially representing a different individuals, and we had both significant number of proponents and opponents for this, and no neutral testimony, and making sure that these groups somehow had a voice in the negotiation so that we can reconcile some of the issues. It still doesn't sit well with me that After the negotiations, we had some individuals come in support, but we still don't have my city, the city of Omaha, my city council people, other individuals, the League of Municipalities also, did they come, were they involved in these negotiations? Oh, sorry, pardon. Would Senator Hilger's yield to a question?
Sure. Am I on the mic? Okay. What was the question?
The League of Municipalities, were they involved in these meetings?
They were involved with some conversations, but I want to be clear, they are opposed.
Okay. I want this to be on the record because I think it's important, especially knowing my constituency, is that the individuals that represent my city, that have a stake in it, are not in support of this bill. And given that, I still do stand against LB 68 in support of the amendment, the Motion 70, because I'm still hearing that as a result of the policy conversations and negotiations that there isn't a step in the right direction that meets the conditions to try to get more people on board with this. And that's what we're trying to do, provide policy that gets more individuals on board and do the best that we can. It's not always a 50-50 compromise, as Senator Hilger's mentioned, but I want to make sure we're getting to a better place. The other thing I just wanted to make sure to call out is that still we're seeing the Sheriff's Department that is not in support of this, city council. For me, one of the other pain points for this is that we're not seeing data-driven pieces that are informing this policy or legislation unless, and I'll make sure to ask as a follow-up off the mic, as to what data pieces are we seeing that say that this is something that we need to immediately address. Oftentimes, we are making policy decisions that are grounded in something that's happened. So many data points are telling us we need to make a change, and I'm not yet hearing that piece of an argument here. So I still stand against this. I appreciate everybody coming to the floor here to talk, and more people are coming in. I will yield the remainder of my time to Senator Crist. Senator Crist.
Thank you, Senator Varga. Senator Crist, half minute.
Very quickly. The Supreme Court is now up to full speed again. I know you all know that. On their docket, one of the items that they intend to take up this year is concealed carry, open carry, as it applies to out of the home and how that applies in terms of jurisdiction. So I would argue that the severability clause would be very important, and if the Supremes rule in a different way, we may be jumping ahead of ourselves on this issue. Thank you for your courtesy, Senator Vargas.
Thanks, Senator Crist. Senator Geist.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I stand in opposition to the Motion 82 to bracket this bill and stand in support of LB 68. And with that, I will yield the rest of my time to Senator Hilgers.
Thank you, Senator Geist. Senator Hilgers, 445.
Thank you, Senator Geist. I appreciate the thoughtful comments. I know Senator Chambers is vehemently opposed, maybe even more aggressively opposed than vehemently opposed, but I do appreciate his comments as the legislation, as I have said multiple times, there's no pride in ownership here, and even if we improve it via Senator Chambers' comments, I don't know if he'll mind too much, but I know he still remains opposed regardless of what we do. I wanted to talk a little bit about this public safety policy issue, and Senator Vargas brought it up, you know, what kind of data do we have? What kind of data do we have to support the impact of this law? And I think as a matter of first principle, we have enough data. We have anecdotal data that shows that people are making an impermissible choice between having a firearm that is constitutionally guaranteed to them under the state and federal constitutions or breaking the law. One is too many when it comes to a constitutional right. Secondly, when we get data, there's not a lot of studies on people who are making that choice. Not everyone's getting arrested. As we saw in all the examples I shared last week, which by the way only came out when the publicity of LB 68 came to the front. When this got into the papers and they understood what we were doing, then we started to hear stories. But the stories we heard were time and again people making this decision. Do I break the law and exercise my right to own a firearm, or do I not break the law and leave myself unprotected? We heard it time and again. So I think from a constitutional perspective, one time's too many, and we've heard a lot of stories, even if there's not a statistically, you know, published study. But I want to talk about the policy implications of this notion of public safety, because I think it's at the core of some of this debate. And I do think it's very important. And on the one side, there's a very strong argument, in my view, that people who are lawful gun owners and who understand how to use a weapon and use it for defensive purposes can help drive down crime. I cited the statistics from the city of Chicago. And when they instituted their gun ban in 1983, they had about, I think it was between 7 and 8 homicide deaths by firearm per 100,000 people. They banned guns. That took away weapons from lawful individuals, lawful citizens. What happened? The murder rate skyrocketed. It skyrocketed. So from a starting place, having individuals being able to protect themselves, I believe, is a deterrent effect and help drive down crime. Now, the opposite side of the spectrum is, well, if you allow too many guns in too many places at too many times, you can drive up crime. So how do we tease these out? How do we tease out which is more? Again, from a policy perspective, I think constitutionally, I think that's undisputed. Or I think it's very clear the constitutional case. And I cited many studies from last week that talks about that these laws of general application that just restrict possession may make us feel good. They may say, boy, we're doing something about gun crime, but they don't actually drive down gun crime. In fact, to the opposite, to the contrary, they can drive up gun crime. So throughout this debate, what we have asked individuals through this compromise process, through this discussion, when we discuss with the police, we say, look, we don't want to make our cities less safe. We don't want to make our municipalities more prone to gun violence. You're on the front lines. Tell us. Tell us. But what we can't hear is just the general notion of, well, let's just restrict guns and then gun crime will sort of go down. Because it statistically it's shown to not be the case. So show us what tools actually help you. In the case of the city of Omaha, they came to us and showed us precisely what helped. Now, we've made that offer to other cities. Hey, when they've come to us, said, hey, look, you tell us what tools do you have and show us how they drive down public safety or how they drive down gun violence. And the same case hasn't been made, colleagues. And I think that's very important. As we're thinking through the policy aspects of this, we have to think about what really does drive down gun crime. And is it the restricting, lawful, nonviolent gun owners, the single mother, the member of our armed forces, their ability to own a weapon? Is that what drives down gun crime? I don't think so. It's an old canard, but I think it's true. The people who are breaking the law, the people who are ignoring our registration ordinance are our lawbreakers. The people who are committing violent crimes at our schools and the mass shootings are not people generally who are following the law when they obtain their firearm. They generally are not deterred by registration ordinances.
Time, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Hilgers. Senator Clements.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm rising in opposition to the Motion 82, but in support of LB 68 and the amendment. I've had quite a few emails on this subject as well, and the great preponderance of them has been in support of this. I'd like to read one from a local farmer in my district. He says, Rob, I would like to have you support LB 68. As it looks like it will level the playing field for those of us who are concerned about the difference among city and town ordinances regarding the legal transport of firearms. I've had a carry concealed permit for about 8 years now, as I was threatened while serving on the board of directors of an international organization around that time. I never know how to be legal when I drive to Omaha, as it has its own regulations. I'm also hoping that each state will have a common reciprocity concerning the legal carry and transport of our firearms. The way some of the laws are now written, there's absolutely no way to defend myself, my family, or others if I have to lock up my firearm, break it down, or transport it in the car trunk. Criminals don't abide by laws in the first place. And the way the laws are now, the law-abiding citizen is made to feel like the criminal because of the current restrictions. Thank you for listening. Signed, Bob. Another letter I'd like to read is from the mayor of the city of Papillion. And he's right close to Omaha. He says, Senator Clements, I wanted to drop a quick note regarding you to encourage support of LB 68. As you know, I'm a large proponent of local control. However, with firearm regulations, uniformly applied rules and regulations applied statewide is critically important. We expect and accept uniformity in a wide number of areas, from licensing requirements for professions to road signage to banking regulations, to water quality, just as four examples. Firearm regulations should be another. I have several practical examples of why LB 68 should be supported, but I'll just share one. It is an unreasonable requirement that lawful firearm transportation in one locality becomes unlawful just by crossing into another. As a state, we should have clear and simple implementation of firearm rules and regulations which are evenly and consistently applied across the state. It doesn't make sense that someone is legal in one town and by virtue of legally driving down a public road, crossing the border into another town, they become illegal. Subtle legal nuances that vary from one locale to another could take an action I do lawfully in Papillion and make that same action unlawful in another city or county. This is not reasonable. David Black, Mayor, City of Papillion. And I agree with those points. We have accepted uniformity and a number of other statewide regulations. And this is another one I believe is appropriate. I'd like to yield the rest of my time to Senator Hilgers.
Thank you, Senator Clements. Senator Hilgers, 1.5 minutes.
Thank you, Senator Clements. Thank you, Mr. President. With about a minute and a half, I want to discuss another issue that we've mentioned before but have not spent a lot of time on. And this implicates not just our Second Amendment and Article I rights to own a firearm. It also impacts our constitutional rights to due process. And that is the Lincoln's prohibited person ordinances. As I've mentioned before, a prohibited person is someone who cannot own a firearm. And in the city of Lincoln, there are about 32. There's a handful at the federal level, there's a handful at the state level, there's 32 in the city of Lincoln. Now, if you're in the city of Lincoln and you get one of these charges, you more than likely will be advised that pleading guilty will result in the loss of your Second Amendment rights. But if you live anywhere else in the state of Nebraska and you have one of these charges, you will not get that notice. But the moment you move to Lincoln, you lose your rights. You lose your Second Amendment rights. That's not fair notice. That's not due process. We take it very seriously. If you're going to plead guilty to a felony and lose your Second Amendment rights, we tell you, you have to have a knowing waiver. You have to enter into that knowingly and intentionally and voluntarily. That does not happen with the city of Lincoln. And the reason is, the problem and what LB 68 will solve is that those decisions ought to be made at the state level. That ought to be made through the committee process here in the legislature, where we can gather data, talk to experts.
Time, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Hilgers. Senator Mirante.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members, good afternoon. I rise in support of LB 68 and the committee amendment and in opposition to both the bracket and the recommit motion. I will start with a question or two of Senator Hilgers.
Senator Hilgers, yield, please.
Absolutely.
Senator Hilgers, it was stated affirmatively on the floor of this legislature towards the beginning of the debate that the attempt to address the concern of Sarpy County citizens and citizens living in suburban Douglas County who do not live within the city limits of the city of Omaha. One of the stated goals of this bill is that simply traveling into the city with a firearm, one of the stated goals was to make that permissible. It was stated on the floor that this bill, as it is currently constructed, does not do that. Is that your understanding?
No, it's not.
How so?
The bill, as under AM 630, provides a safe transport provision. Now, in the green copy, there is no restriction whatsoever. But in AM 630, because of the restrictions in Omaha, there's included within it the ability to travel safely with your firearm without breaking the law.
This is important because Senator Vargas asked for data points. I'll give you one. All 37,000 of my constituents live on the border of Omaha. The vast majority of those constituents travel to Omaha every single weekday. So unless LB 68 with the committee amendment is adopted, we are putting them in a situation where by driving into the city of Omaha to go to work or to watch a baseball game, simply by being there, they're criminals if they have a firearm. That's wrong. Now, I've heard Senator Hilger's, yes, he had negotiations and he took away a major source of opposition, but he has not eliminated all opposition. Colleagues, I would ask you to standard that we would apply to ourselves. And we are at the point right now where I'm hearing some opposition, some of which is practical in nature and not philosophical in nature. Is it okay to carry a gun into the Pinnacle Bank Arena? Senator Hilgers says under the bill the answer is still no. It's not his intent to legalize that, but he's willing to negotiate a compromise to make it clear that that's not his intent and to ensure that major public venues like that cannot have firearms in them. But one thing I know for sure, if you do not vote to invoke cloture, we cannot make those clarifications. The only way that we can make those clarifications to satisfy your concerns is to invoke cloture, get this bill to select file, and we can attach an amendment to satisfy those concerns. If you vote no, the bill's dead. There's nothing we can do. We have to come back next year. So if you are, to those who say they support the fundamental goal, but they want some clarification, if you're sincere in that belief, vote to invoke cloture. Then we have time to work together. Senator Hilgers has said over and over and over again, he will talk and work with anyone, anytime, anywhere to come up with support that does not undermine the fundamental purpose of LB 68. And we could do that. We could solve those goals. It's been said, we can't support this legislation because it invites lawsuit of municipalities. The only way municipalities would be under threat of lawsuit is if they openly disregard our state law. That's it. So if you have another remedy, I'm open to it. Some sort of enforcement mechanism, I'm all ears. I'm sure Senator Hilgers is as well. But what do we do in the situation where a municipality would say, the state legislature has taken action, the governor has signed the bill, and we just don't care? We're going to ignore it. There has to be some sort of mechanism for dealing with that. So I implore you, if you're sincere when you say you're open-minded, you want a compromise, don't really hate the Second Amendment, then vote to invoke cloture and we'll figure it out. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Morante. Senator Chambers.
Thank you. Mr. President, members of the legislature, I'm going to read this for the record. On page 12, line 20, it starts. Then I'm going to drop down to line 20. So this is starting in line 20, then I'll drop down to line 30. A city of the first class may regulate and prevent the transportation or storage of gunpowder. The city is authorized specifically to do that. Then when you go to page 13 in line 22, cities and villages do not have the power to regulate the transportation of ammunition. Then the definition of ammunition is on page 15. Ammunition means propellant powder. So there's the specific authorization of the cities to regulate gunpowder and the transportation of it. They can prohibit it. The definition of ammunition includes propellant or gunpowder. But then the bill prohibits the cities from regulating ammunition or gunpowder. So in the law right now, the city is specifically authorized to regulate gunpowder. In this law, in the committee amendment, cities are prohibited from regulating gunpowder. The definition of ammunition includes propellant powder, which is gunpowder. You're going to present something like that to the court. Let's say I file the declaratory judgment. The courts will say, as they have said, we will not read anything into a law that is not there. We will not read anything out of a law that is there. So when you have two diametrically opposite statements in the same law, the only thing the court can do is say this law is unconstitutional because it renders action both legal and illegal specifically. And then I've mentioned some of those other items that I would bring forth in a declaratory judgment. And because I don't like to make idle threats, I'd like to be laughed at by the NRA. And I'd like John Bruning to tell the rest of you all, because he sees you all as suckers, don't listen to Ernie. Yeah, he won some lawsuits back then. This is now. Well, John Bruning is paid to make fools out of you all. And I could write a list of those who are going to support this bill right now. If you should get cloture because you think amendments are going to be drafted, forget it, because I have enough priority amendments to make sure that on select file, if it gets there, you'll not get a chance to offer any amendments. And you will be stuck with this contradictory bill. And when you get to final reading, the only way you can amend it is to bring it back for a specific amendment. And if the amendment is adopted, the bill doesn't immediately go back to final reading. It has to go through the process of the work that is done in the bill drafter's office. But because I'm strategizing, not just working tactically, I withdraw my pending motion to bracket the bill, which drops us back to my motion to recommit it to committee. So I'm withdrawing that bracket motion, Mr. President.
Without objection, motion 82 to bracket is withdrawn. Senator Reapy.
Mr. President and fellow colleagues, I stand in support of AM 630 and LB 680. I yield the balance of my time to Senator Hilgers as he teaches us the art of the deal.
Thank you, Senator Reapy. Senator Hilgers.
Thank you, Senator Reapy. And we have worked very hard to try to make a deal. And we have, in my view, a very good deal. And there's an old saying that says the best deals are the ones where both sides aren't happy. And I think that's absolutely true here. If you ask the Omaha police, sure, they're not jumping up and down supporting LB 68 because they love it. And we're not jumping up and down because we think that the amendment is the best thing that we ever wanted. But in all good compromises comes pain. And so we did make a deal, Senator Reapy, and I think it's a good deal. And that's the deal that's in front of us today. I want to read another story from somebody that I received. Another voice who wants to speak on this issue. And this is from Carol in Louisville. My daughter received a scholarship and planned to attend UNO. This would be the first time she lived away from home. We found her an apartment near campus and made all arrangements for her to move in a couple of weeks before school started. As an 18-year-old young lady, her father and I were concerned about her living alone and decided to provide her a handgun for protection when she was in her apartment. Luckily, we found out sooner than later that this was not legal in Omaha. Everywhere else in the state of Nebraska, we could ensure our daughter's safety and have peace of mind that if she needed it, she'd have a way to defend herself, but not in Omaha. Because she wasn't yet 21, she couldn't legally have one. So we discussed it as a family. We decided the best thing would be for her to transfer to Peru State College. She's a smart girl and with a great future ahead of her. While we were disappointed that she couldn't attend a great school like UNO, she and we felt her safety was more important. Colleagues, these stories don't make the front page of the news. They ought to, but they don't. People live in silence. Some people don't know they're breaking the law. They're doing it anyway. Some people do know, but they make their own decisions. They can't afford lawyers. They don't have time to make a big issue out of this. How many of you besides Senator Chambers has filed a lawsuit against a municipality or against the state? I'm willing to bet the answer is close to zero. These hardworking individuals who struggle to find the time for a concealed carry license permit to get the training necessary so that they can go through the city of Omaha and not break the law, they're going to be filing lawsuits? That's the burden we're placing on our fellow citizens, colleagues. Now, we've already done preemption in Nebraska. About 10 years ago, we passed the Concealed Carry Permit Act, which allows licensed concealed carry holders, permit holders, to travel anywhere in the state. The cities cannot regulate concealed carry or those who possess concealed carry weapons. They can't. That's already in state law. We've already taken that away from the cities. And I think by all accounts, that's been a very successful law. We've already taken away part of the ability of cities to govern possession, and now we're doing the other part. Why should it be that only those who can afford a permit and afford the training should be able to exercise their Second Amendment rights? Why should that be the case? I submit it should not be. This is good policy for these individuals. Let's let them be heard. I think it has been said many times already, but I want to repeat it, and I will probably repeat it two or three or four more times. I think the over-under is probably 3.5. This does not expose cities to unnecessary liability. If they follow state law, which they should, they will not be sued. And if they are sued, that means they're not following state law. And if they are being sued, actually, this statute gives them a mechanism. Senator Chambers discussed a declaratory judgment action. Declaratory judgment action is something where you can ask the court to declare in a judgment. That's where the word, that's what it means. In a judgment that a law is unconstitutional. And you can do that. And the reason why you could do that for unconstitutional laws. And the reason you could do that is because we don't want to have people have to have their constitutional rights infringed before they can bring a lawsuit, at least for what's called a facial challenge. We already allow that. Now, but if the city is just circumventing state law.
Time, sir.
And it, thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Hillinger. Senator Friesen.
Thank you, Mr. Lieutenant Governor. I stand in support of LB 68. When I've followed different handgun regulations and firearms regulations, and I watch a little bit how Chicago does things. In the city of Chicago, what they would do is they would pass an ordinance that was definitely unconstitutional, and then they would leave it in place until someone finally challenged it, and when they challenged it and lost, they would just pass another law that was obviously unconstitutional, and that's how they played the game. And so whoever had the most money there to challenge those laws, they were the ones that always had to step forward and challenge the law, take it through the system, which took a couple of years, and in the meantime, they had the ability to enforce unconstitutional laws. And so when I look at the ability for us to sue a municipality that, for instance, maintains those laws on the books, it's not a burden that they shouldn't bear. It's very easy for them to go in, clean up their rules and regs, laws, and make it so that they would not be subject to that lawsuit. If Senator Hillinger would take the rest of my time, I would yield the remainder of my time to Senator
Hillinger. Thank you, Senator Friesen. Senator Hillinger, 3:45.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Friesen, for the time. I was talking about declaratory judgments, and in the context, I'm glad Senator Moorfield's here because he understands this and with the organization that he runs. It's very important when it comes to constitutional rights to be able to challenge statutes that are facially unconstitutional. You don't have to wait for your constitutional rights to be violated. You're able to have standing to go to a courtroom and challenge it. When it's a municipal ordinance that is not violating the constitution per se, but it's violating LB 68, if we didn't have this provision in statute, what would have to happen is we'd have to wait for somebody to have that statute, the ordinance applied against them and enforced against them. And that would likely mean that they are being arrested, they get a ticket, and that has all sorts of ancillary downstream costs for that individual. Senator Chambers and I had a back and forth about actual damages, and what kind of actual damages could you have? Well, if it's not a facial challenge, and it's actually a challenge after the statute's been ordinance has been enforced against you, that there could be significant actual damages. You could lose your job. That's pretty significant. If you are an employee at Offutt Air Force Base right now, there are certain charges you cannot have on your record, or you lose your security clearance and you lose your job. If it's enforced against you, you get ticketed, you could have real significant harm, tens of thousands of dollars potentially. Now, if there's a facial challenge, in other words, you don't have to wait for it to be enforced against you, then you can go to court right away. Now, again, this should never happen. It should never happen. It should not happen. I will repeat it over and over again. The city should not enforce ordinances as to possession if the state takes away their power. But if they do, or if they don't get them off the books and they'll have time to do that, then a citizen ought to be able to sue. It's a similar mechanism that we have had for hundreds of years in this country for declaratory judgment actions, facial challenges to unconstitutional statutes. It is not an unheard of proposition. And in fact, it could save the cities and municipalities money, because instead of dealing with a case with significant actual damages, out-of-pocket costs, there really is a far more nominal fee. And frankly, it's something that ought to be cleared up with just a letter if they intend to do it. So I think that's incredibly important. And I've talked about the mechanism in that statute that allows membership organizations to support. Now, it's been portrayed as, well, geez, the last thing we just don't want to have, this is an NRA bill. We want, you know, this is going to allow the NRA just to go on a spree, and they're just going to sue every municipality from the western part of the state to the eastern part of the state. It's not that, colleagues. It's not. There are organizations on all sorts of issues across the ideological spectrum who are there either as a primary part of their mission or just a part of their mission to support and defend people's rights. The ACLU is a perfect example. If you think that the NRA or the Nebraska Firearm Owners Association shouldn't be allowed to use their expertise to help people protect their Second Amendment rights, then you should think that the ACLU can't help individuals protect their own rights. They're two sides of the same coin, colleagues. That provision is a common sense provision that frankly ought never to be used, and I'd be shocked if it was ever used, because the cities would do the right thing if LB 68 passed. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Hilgers. Mr. Clerk.
Mr. President, priority motion, Senator Moorefield would move to bracket the bill until June 2nd.
Senator Moorefield, you recognize to open on your bracket motion.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I know that we're coming near the time to invoke cloture, and I want to go through and summarize some of my concerns about this legislation and also respond to Senator Hilgers. First, this legislation goes far beyond the intended purpose of the legislation or the stated purported purpose of this legislation, which is to ensure that people traveling from one municipality or one jurisdiction to another can do so and transport their firearms safely and without any hindrance by local ordinances. That was the purported reason when this legislation was first introduced in the Judiciary Committee 3 years ago. That was one of the reasons why, at the time, I decided to support that legislation and forward it on. When I read into the bill more, I realized, like many others, including our own county sheriff here, that this bill has ramifications and implications well beyond the transport of firearms across the state. Well beyond. In fact, it takes away at least a dozen or so ordinances in the city of Lincoln. It'll do the same in Omaha while maintaining a special ordinance for them that nobody else in the state gets to avail themselves of. We have gun crime in North Lincoln. We have gun crime in North Omaha. We have gun crime in Grand Island. We have gun crime in many other places in this state that have unique situations and different contexts than other parts of the state. As a gun owner, you have a heightened responsibility. Not just you, I have a heightened responsibility as a gun owner to ensure that I'm following all laws. These laws are not overly burdensome, and if they're overly burdensome, you already have options. Number one, as a citizen, you can already challenge the constitutionality of a law if it's applied against you and you feel as though it's unconstitutional. That's the way our court system works. As a legislature, if we feel as though an ordinance in the city of Lincoln is unreasonable, whether it be a prohibited person, as Senator Hildreth suggested, or otherwise, then we can introduce a law taking away the city's direct authority on that specific issue. What we shouldn't do is simply wipe all ability for cities to respond to unique situations in their municipality to deal with unique issues in their community. Now, Senator Clements read off a note from a constituent in his district, and he noted that that person had a concealed carry permit. Senator Clements, they would still be able to conceal carry in the city of Omaha, because that's in state law. It's already in state law. This bill doesn't make it any easier or any better for your constituent. That will be maintained in state law. That's already the case. They can already go into Omaha with their concealed carry permit. Senator Hildreth, in response to me getting up and saying, I don't know who's having a problem with this right now. There hasn't been any compelling stories. He talked about how he read from notes from single mothers, much like my own, military members and other individuals who want to have the right to bear arms. They already do. The single mother, and Senator Geist, who also noted that she feels more protected and safer with her firearm in her home, they still currently have the right to bear arms. I have the right to bear arms in my home, and I do. Those individuals have the ability to do that now. And there was nothing about the stories that they read, and I was listening to Senator Hildreth a week or two ago, there was nothing in their stories that said that they weren't able, under our current statutory framework, to be able to do that. A single mother can have their firearm. A member of the armed forces can have their firearm, unless, of course, there's a state statute or an applicable ordinance. And usually there's a good reason for those ordinances, and usually there's a good reason for that state statute. And if there isn't a good reason for it, we can look at individual statutes and ordinances, and I'm willing to do that. I also want to talk a little bit about the possession side and the trespass a little bit more before we end today. Senator Hildreth has said on one hand he believes the trespass statute applies. And then on the other hand, he also says, well, I'm willing to compromise on that on select. And then we have Senator Chambers who says, I'm not going to let anybody get to any amendments on select. So even if there is a compromise amendment, Senator Chambers isn't going to let us get to it, and that's generally how he runs these things. And not only that, there is no way that a reasonable court is going to look at this and go, well, you know, the state legislature passed a law specifically prohibiting cities and municipalities from passing ordinances, rules, or measures, otherwise they can be sued right away. And the trespass statute, they can still apply that against somebody who is in possession of a gun. It makes no sense. On one hand, we're saying specifically cities can't regulate the possession of firearms. On the other hand, we're saying, well, you know, there's a trespass statute, so, you know, that generalized trespass statute can't apply. Well, unless there's an amendment to the bill that states that, that's not how a court's going to interpret the plain meaning of that legislation. And that's what the court goes to first the plain meaning. And then they look at, is there a more specific statute that represents the intent of the legislature in specific instances, such as gun possession, which if we pass this bill, there will be. And then they're going to look at the trespass statute. And when they look at the trespass statute, you're only trespassing if you've violated some kind of notice or some kind of rule that either the private individual or, in this case, the city, who we just prohibited regulating the possession of firearms, that they violated. And Senator Hilders has stated, well, you know, posting a sign up or something like that, that may not be an ordinance or a rule. Well, I printed off the Merriam-Webster Dictionary definition of rule, a prescribed guide for conduct or action. If posting a sign saying you can't bring in firearms into a public facility that you otherwise would have isn't a prescribed guide for conduct or action, then I don't know what is. That's a rule. That's a rule that somebody has prescribed, in this case, a governmental entity that is prohibited from regulating the possession of firearms. The trespass statutes would not apply. And if you look at the memo to Mayor Beitler from their police legal advisor that I had passed around by the pages earlier today, I think that there's some interesting points that they make and that inform what we're doing here. It states, supporters of AM 630 and LB 68 argue that cities and counties can rely on state criminal trespass statutes as a mean of preventing the open carry of firearms into city-county buildings. Criminal trespass would not be an option for cities and counties if AM 630 and LB 68 passes. Currently, the city of Lincoln can lawfully adopt rules, regulations, ordinances, and/or take measures to prevent open carry of firearms into or onto governmental property. While criminal trespass is currently a mechanism to enforce legally valid ordinance, local ordinance, or rule, AM 630 with LB 68 strips cities and counties of the ability to enact said rule or ordinance in order for them to be in violation of the criminal trespass statute. Pardon me, Mr. President?
1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I won't go on much longer because I know that we're getting close to the cloture vote. I am not opposed to gun possession. I own a firearm. I am in support of responsible policy that allows for local control to react to the varying circumstances of their locality or city or county. That is responsible. And maintaining that local control is critical because the reality in Ainsworth is a lot different than the reality in North Lincoln or North Omaha. And rightfully so. We come from different communities, different contexts. This is not responsible lawmaking. The responsible thing to do would be to pinpoint the local ordinances that we think are burdensome and without merit or value and introduce legislation not allowing the localities to be able to enact those ordinances. Not wiping them off all the books. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, Senator Moorfield. Senator Hughes.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to yield my time to Senator Hilders, if you would like.
Thank you, Senator Hughes. Senator Hilders, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Hughes. Colleagues, again, thank you for the debate on LB 68, both last week and this week. I think it was informative and thoughtful and raised the profile of what I think is an under-discussed but important, very important issue, which are individuals who are having to make a choice between breaking the law or exercising the right to bear arms. That's guaranteed by our constitutions. Now, you will all be the judge and the jury on this next vote. You will help determine whether or not this bill proceeds. And if I was in a courtroom and I was closing, one of the things I might do is weigh the arguments on either side. And on one side, the proponents of LB 68 say we've got a constitutional right to bear arms, undisputed. People are having to make a choice between breaking the law or owning their weapon, undisputed. We have a patchwork of laws that are depriving people of due process, undisputed. It's a pretty strong case, colleagues. Now, on the other side, we've heard a number of different arguments. In no particular order. We've heard, well, this is special legislation. It's not, colleagues. It's not an arbitrary class. It's not a closed class. It's not special legislation. We've heard that this will create lawsuit after lawsuit after lawsuit for the cities. Not true. If the cities follow state law, there will not be one lawsuit. That is premised on the idea that they won't do what the legislature says that they should do. Not true. We've heard this will open up guns everywhere, anytime, for any purpose. Also, not true. Senator Moorfield and I have had the discussion regarding the impact of trespass. We didn't repeal that law. But I don't have any problem with having a belt and suspenders approach. And I do think we can get an amendment on select file. The next argument has been, well, this will impact public safety. What evidence, I say? The answer is, well, it'll affect public safety. This will be guns everywhere all the time. What evidence? Well, we don't really have any. What can you point to help me suggest that you're right, that we ought to tie in and depress our right to bear arms under the Constitution? There's none. The only evidence that's been brought to me, is from the Omaha Police Department. And to their great credit, they have gone through in significant detail, both anecdotally and data-wise, why they need certain tools to fight gang violence in Chicago. In Omaha. So that's why that is in AM 630. Colleagues, there's been a lot of hand-waving. There's been a lot of conclusory arguments. And I would ask you to look at the evidence. Look at what's before us. Not the 10,000-foot discussions of, well, this will impact public safety without evidence, or this is unconstitutional without evidence. Look at the evidence. There are real people being impacted and having their Second Amendment rights taken away from them. We have real due process issues in the city of Lincoln. LB 68 is a significant step in the right direction. It was formed through a very significant compromise, how this legislature ought to operate. Two sets of people coming from different sides on different issues, working together to come forward with something neither one of them really love, but one that they can be satisfied with.
1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. LB 68 is that compromise. It helps citizens in our state exercise their right to have a firearm, bear arms. That's guaranteed to them by both constitutions, while ensuring that where there is real evidence of public safety risk, that is addressed. That's what this does. I urge you, there's going to be a motion for cloture here in a minute, and I urge you to vote green on that motion. And if you're going to vote at all, I ask you to vote. Please don't be present not voting. If you're going to filibuster this bill, if you're going to kill this bill by filibuster, vote no. But I ask you to not do that. Vote green. Let us get to select file. Let us address some of these concerns and have a good bill for Nebraska citizens move forward. So I urge you to vote green on the motion for cloture, red on the other motions, a green on AM 630, and a green on the underlying bill, LB 68. Thank you so much for the debate, colleagues. I'm very grateful for this discussion.
Thank you, Senator Hilgers. Mr. Clerk, do you have a motion at the desk?
I do, Mr. President. Senator Hilgers would move to invoke cloture pursuant to Rule 7, Section 10.
It's the ruling of the chair that there has been a full and fair debate afforded to LB 68. There's been a request to place House on a call. The question is, shall the House go on a call? All those in favor vote aye. Those opposed vote nay. Record, Mr. Clerk.
28 ayes, 1 nay to go on a call, Mr. President.
The House is on the call. Senators, please record your presence. Those unexcused senators outside the chamber, please return to the chamber, record your presence. All unauthorized personnel, please leave the floor. The House is under call. Senators Moorfield, Bowles, Pansing, Brooks, Wayne, please check in. Senator Brewer, please return to the chamber. Check in. Looking for Senator Bowles and Senator Brewers. Senator Bowles and Senator Brewer, the House on a call. Please return to the chamber. Record your presence. We're lacking Senator Bowles at this point. It's been a request for roll call vote in regular order. Members, the first vote is a motion of cloture. Those in favor say aye. Those opposed say nay. Mr. Clerk, roll call vote, please.
Senator Albright. Voting yes. Senator Baker. Yes. Voting yes. Senator Blood. No. Voting no. Senator Bowles. Not voting. Senator Bostelman. Voting yes. Senator Brosh. Voting yes. Senator Brewer. Voting yes. Senator Breezy. Voting yes. Senator Chambers. Voting no. Senator Clements. Voting yes. Senator Craighead. Voting yes. Senator Crawford. Voting no. Senator Ebke. Voting yes. Senator Erdman. Voting yes. Senator Friesen. Voting yes. Senator Geist. Voting yes. Senator Groney. Voting yes. Senator Halloran. Voting yes, Senator Hansen. Yes. Voting no, Senator Haar. Senator Hilgers. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Hilkeman. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Howard. Senator Hughes. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Kulowski. No. Voting no, Senator Colderman. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Crist. Senator Crist? Not voting. Senator Keene. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Larson. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Lindstrom. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Linehan. Voting yes, Senator Lowe. Yes. Voting yes, Senator McAllister. Yes. Voting yes, Senator McDonnell. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Moorfield. No. Voting no, Senator Morandi. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Pansing Brooks. Voting no, Senator Quick. Voting no, Senator Reapy. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Scheer. Voting yes, Senator Shoemaker. Not voting, Senator Smith. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Stinner. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Vargas. Not voting, Senator Walls. Senator Watermeyer. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Wayne. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Williams. Yes. Voting yes, Senator Wishart. No. Not voting. Vote is 33 yeas, 8 nays, Mr. President.
Cloture is invoked. The next vote will be to take a vote on the Moorfield bracket motion. Those in favor vote aye. Those opposed vote nay. Have you all voted care to? Record, Mr. Clerk.
Eleven ayes, 31 nays on the motion to bracket the bill, Mr. President.
The bracket motion is not adopted. The next vote is on Senator Chambers' motion to recommit the bill to committee. Those in favor vote aye. Those opposed vote nay. Have you all voted? Record, Mr. Clerk.
Twelve ayes, 30 nays on the motion to recommit, Mr. President.
The recommit motion is not adopted. The next vote is on the adoption of the committee amendment, AM 630. Those in favor vote aye. Those opposed vote nay. Have you all voted? Record, Mr. Clerk.
33 yeas, 11 nays on the adoption of committee amendments.
The committee amendments are adopted. The next vote is to advance LB 68 to ENR initial. Those in favor vote aye. Those opposed vote nay. Have you all voted? A record vote has been requested by Senator Morante. Record, Mr. Clerk.
Voting aye, Senators Albright, Baker, Bostelman, Brosh, Brewer, Breezy, Clements, Craighead, Ebke, Erdman,
Friesen, Groney, Halloran, Hilgers, Hilkeman, Hughes, Calderman, Keene, Larson, Lindstrom, Linehan, Lowe, McAllister, McDonald, Moranti, Reapy, Shear, Smith, Stenner, Watermeyer, and Williams. Voting no, Senators Blood, Chambers, Crawford, Geist, and Senator Hansen, Kalowski, Crist, Moorfield, Pansy, Brooks, Quick, Burgers, Wayne, and Wishart. Senator Geist? Voting yes. Vote is 32 A's, 12 nays on the motion to advance the bill, Mr. President.
LB 68 advances. Pursuant to the Speaker's directive, we'll move back to the morning discussion. Oh, I raise the call. Mr. Clerk, when you're ready, you can announce the bill.
Mr. President, next bill, Legislative Bill 158, introduced by Senator Pansing Brooks. It's a bill for an act relating to the appointment of counsel for juveniles and standards for guardian ad litem and attorneys for juvenile court. The bill was considered by the legislature this morning. At that time, there was consideration of amendment from Senator Pansing Brooks, AM 996. That amendment failed. We are now considering a pending motion to reconsider the vote on the adoption of that amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. We'll proceed immediately to the discussion. Senator Moorfield.
Am I up next?
Yes, you're recognized, Senator Moorfield.
Thank you. Colleagues, I rise in support of Senator Crist's reconsideration and in support of Senator Pansing Brooks' bill. I wasn't able to speak on it this morning because I was ill and preparing for LB 68, but I think this is a critical issue, ensuring that juveniles have the right to counsel. And I heard a lot of the debate down in my office. I heard Senator Groney's comments and other individuals, but the bottom line is that our juvenile justice system often makes it so that juveniles barely have a chance to be successful citizens and adults at a very early age. And Senator Pansing Brooks' legislation allows for that representation and ensures that they have the constitutional right to representation and due process. Now, I know that there is some finagling over what the funding mechanism is or is not, but this bill deserves to go on to select file. This bill deserves to give our young Nebraskans the ability to have fair representation in court, whether they're in our larger municipalities or whether they're in our more rural areas. And with that, I would yield the remainder of my time to Senator Pansing Brooks.
Thank you, Senator Moorfield. Senator Pansing Brooks, 3.5 minutes.
Thank you, Senator Moorfield, and thank you, Mr. Lieutenant Governor. If you would please look, I know that everybody was talking through some of the discussion earlier. The Juvenile Legal Defense report that the state of Nebraska paid $250,000 for has an executive summary, which you have on your desk. The significant findings are that we are excessive waiver of counsel. It says the right to counsel in delinquency proceedings is a constitutional right. Fundamental fairness requires that defense counsel is appointed early in the youth's case, the youth has a meaningful opportunity to consult with the attorney, and investigate and test the strength of the government's case, explain potential short and long-term consequences of a conviction, review the sufficiency of the case prior to the court's accepting a plea agreement, and is afforded